get in agreement, get in faith with us about that. Just the way it'll be, okay? Now, Romans chapter 8, verses 1 and 2, which is our foundation text, says, there is therefore now. Somebody say now.
Now.
Somebody say right now.
Right.
There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. There's no adverse sentence. There's no verdict. There's no judgment against them that God has not already cleared them from. And I used an example on last week about the woman who was caught in adultery. There's just so much truth in that story. You know, the people who caught her in the adultery, it's amazing how we always want to throw stones at other people, right? And Jesus turned it right back on them and he said, if you're without sin, then cast the first stone. And the scripture told us that they immediately began to walk away one by one from the eldest to the oldest. But the revelation in that was Jesus had to ask her a question, which was simply this. Where are your accusers? Is there no one that condemns you? He needed her to own this and he needed her to say it. Her response was, no, master, no one condemns me. Then he said to her, well, neither do I. Go and sin no more. Now notice, people will treat you this way. They'll basically say, when you stop doing that, then I'll bless you, or I'll do something for you. That's not the way it works in the kingdom. Notice, once she got a revelation of who she was in Christ and that he was not condemning her, once she knew that the people couldn't condemn her, she wouldn't condemn her herself, Jesus said, then I'm not going to condemn you either. Then he instructed her to go and sin no more. Now, God would be unrighteous if that story was in the scripture, if she went out and continued to live a sinful lifestyle, right or wrong. It wouldn't be in here. Clearly, she walked away from here free because she understood and had a revelation that God was not condemning her. That's what gave her the foundation and the power to walk free from sin. It's when we know who we are in him that sin no longer has any power or it can't do any damage to us in our lives, okay? So I wanted to make sure I reiterated that. It says, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. And here's the key. Who walk not according to the flesh, to tread all around in, walk at large, which is what the word walk means, or to be occupied with things that are external or carnal, fleshly thinking. Very few people, if any in this room, live their lives outside of Christ. I don't believe that. I believe most of the people in this room are here because you love God. Am I right about that? Right? Most of the people that are in this room are here because you want to grow in God and you want the benefits of all that God has already provided for you. So really, we're not talking to the majority of the people that are in this room. And I don't know about you, that's a blessing to be in the household of faith, okay? So he says, but according to the Spirit, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. So we can clearly see there are two laws operating in the earth today. The law of the Spirit of life, which is in Christ Jesus. And notice that law supersedes or overrides the law of sin and death. So if I just stay in that one, how do you know I don't have to be concerned about sin and death? Right? So really, if we just focus on life, death has no power or no ability where we're concerned, okay? And that's the principle here. We said several other things around that. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. Faith is an important deal. You know, we can't please God without faith, right? So we have to be fully persuaded. We have to trust that God is who he said he is. And what I love there, when we come to him, we have to believe that he is a rewarder. God is not a punisher. God is a rewarder. God wants to bless you. He wants to answer your prayers. He wants to heal your body. He wants to get you your dream job. He wants to bless your business. He wants to restore your marriage. And for the single people, he wants to bring the mate of your dreams into your life. Whoa, I thought I would have got a much stronger amen than that one. But he wants to. And he gets no greater joy, as you'll see at the end of this message, than answering your prayers the way you present them to him. All right? So now, we said several things, okay? And right now what we're looking at is seven spiritual laws of prayer. Now remember, because we're operating under the law of the Spirit of life, which is in Christ Jesus, we're not talking about steps that you have to follow to get God to do something. Is that clear? It's not what we're talking about here. These are just laws that are in the earth that when we operate in them, and how many of them release what's already here? So we're not trying to get blessed, we're already blessed. Amen. And when we operate in these laws, it releases what's already present, and we're able to walk in the manifestation of it, okay? So the first one, law number one, was we have to ask, right? We won't say anything else about that. We said enough. You can go back to SoundCloud. We left off last week talking about you must ask the Father in Jesus' name, okay? Let me just remind us of some things before I say what I need to say today. Under the first covenant, Hebrew men approached God in prayer by addressing him as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now, you've got to remember that Jesus didn't come to do away with the law. He came to do what? To fulfill, right? So obviously, anything that he's asking us to do today is a fulfillment of where we were yesterday, right? So these Old Testament patriarchs could not go to the Father on their own merit. They had to go to the Father based off of the covenant and promises that he made to these three individuals. And we looked at three examples in particular. We looked at David, we looked at Moses, and we looked at Abraham. Moses, as an example of going on your own merit, Moses lost 40 years of his life trying to do things his own way. How many of y'all can honestly say, I can see the results of trying to do stuff my own way? Or how many of y'all have seen the results of doing things your own way? I certainly have, and we all have. And so Moses, at the age of 40, here he is. He knows what he's called to do. He actually knows who he is, and he's out there, and he sees one of his Hebrew brothers being beaten by an Egyptian slave. And as a result of that, he goes to defend, or I guess we can use this word, deliver his brothers from the Egyptian bondage. And he kills the Egyptian soldier and buries him. And in his mind, no one saw it. So when he shows up to work the next day, he's talking to one of the Egyptian soldiers. And the Egyptian soldier says, are you going to kill me like you did the soldier yesterday? And Moses immediately knew that his secret was out. And so he fled for his life. And we know that that cost him 40 years of his life on the backside. Why? Because he was trying to do that in his own merit. Right? And then now think back when it was time to go back and deliver the children of Israel from Egyptian bondage. First question that God Moses asked God was, who should I tell the people sent me? God simply said to him, Moses, I don't have time to tell you everything I can do in all of my name. He said, just tell them I am sent you. But then he gave specific directions. He said, go and see the elders of Israel and tell them that the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob sent me to deliver you. Now, there's so much truth and revelation in that. So clearly, if Moses would have just went back to them and said, I'm Moses, I'm here to deliver you, they probably wouldn't have received that. Or they probably would have been reminded of the 40 years prior to that, yeah, just like you did 40 years ago. But it was something about when those elders heard that, that they were able to encourage 3 million plus people to now follow Moses and his directions out of Egyptian bondage. And the key there was tell them that the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob sent. All right? So once he won on that merit, he could get results. Now, let's fast forward that to the New Testament. I'm just taking my time to re-explain that, because today will make all the sense in the world as we wrap up this point today. Okay? Now, so he did that. You all know the rest of the story. We looked at several other examples. Now, go back to Hebrews chapter 7. We know that in John, 3 separate times, actually 7 when you count them all, he instructed us to ask the Father in his what? Name, right? And name there is a Greek word, onuma, which means authority and character. So most of my saved life, I thought I had to use my authority as a believer to get results in prayer. And then I also thought that my character had to match Jesus' character in order to get results in prayer. I've now learned through this revelation that I'm not using my authority, I'm using Christ's authority. I'm not using my character, because I don't have to go far to realize mine doesn't measure up. I don't even have to go back a week to realize my character is not good enough to stand in the presence of God. Right? So I'm not using my character. There's really nothing I can do in terms of what he's made me to improve on my position as being right before God, because I didn't do anything to earn it. I can't do anything to make it better. It's something that has been bestowed upon me, all right? You're going to need to understand that when we get to this point that I want to get to today, all right? And so that's how we go to the Father. We use his authority, we use his character. Now, Christ is the heavenly high priest ever living. And so we're 50% accurate when we understand that Christ is seated at the right hand of God the Father. How many of y'all believe that Christ right now is seated at the right hand? Raise your hand if you believe that. And he is. And we're going to understand. I'm going to reiterate that today again. But he's also doing something else. He's not just seated. He's also doing something in addition to that. So Christ is the heavenly high priest, and he ever lives to make intercessions for us. Hebrews chapter 7, let's read verses 20 through 25. Says, and inasmuch as he was not made priest without an oath, which means promise, for they have become priests without an oath, but he with an oath by him, God, who said to him, the Lord has sworn and will not relent and won't take it back, for you are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. What was that order? He had no recorded father, no recorded mother. He had no beginning of days and no end. By so much more, Jesus has become a surety of a better covenant. Also, there were many priests because they were prevented by death from continuing. Twofold, they died of natural causes. Others died because when they went into the Holy of Holies, their lives were not right, and so they died in the Holy of Holies. But he, because he continued how long? How long? How long? All right. Forever has an unchangeable priesthood. Therefore, he is able to save to the uttermost. And I want to reiterate that today. That word save there means sozo. So clearly, he's able to deliver, to protect, to heal, to preserve, to cause to do well, to make whole. If we don't know that, how many of y'all believe he's able to do that? Simply means whatever situation you're in right now, God is able to deliver you, protect you, heal you, preserve you, cause you to do well, and make you whole in any and every area of your life. And I want you to understand that this is why he died, to provide this for you. And he doesn't just do it. What I love here, he's able to save to the uttermost. And this word uttermost here means full ending, entirely, and completely. So in other words, whatever he starts, God is able to finish. So he's not just trying to get you a job so that you can get some groceries this weekend. He wants your life to be so blessed that you can pay your house off, your car off, and then be a blessing to somebody else. Right? He wants you so healed that you believe in it so much that it spills off of you and on to other people, that they get healed as a result of what's on you. God is not just trying to get you married. He's trying to get you the marriage that you've always dreamed about, so that you can have the kids that you always dreamed about, so that they can grow up and be kingdom kids, be a blessing to the kingdom of God. I want you to understand, he's not just able to save you or deliver you. He's able to do it fully and completely. Folks, he did not give us West End Seventh-day Adventist Church and Marietta Performing Arts Center. He didn't provide those for us just so that we can have somewhere to rent every 30 days. He put us in a holding place on our way to the permanent building that he's already provided for us, cash. Come on, somebody don't understand. Somebody don't understand what I'm saying. And everything that we have now is preparing us for what he has for us entirely. He's not finished, folks. He's just getting started in your life. And you may just be getting sprinkles of the fullness of everything that he has. Man, I tell you, I wish there was a little bit more faith in this room. Okay? Watch this. He's able to save to the uttermost. Never saw this before. Here's the revelation. Those who come to God through him. What does that mean? Those who come to God through him. What does that mean? What are we talking about there? Don't everyone answer that at the same time. So we're talking about going to the Father through prayer. Right? In his name. Right? So come to the Father by him. Watch this. Since he always lives to make intercessions for us. Amen. So he always lives to make intercessions for who? Those who go to the Father through him. So that means then he's taking something that we're requesting and presenting it to the Father on our behalf. That's what the word intercede means, is to intercede on behalf of someone else. So once again, it further confirms that we're not there on our own merit. Now, most people are here, I'm going somewhere with this today, which is why I'm taking my time. I'm really going somewhere with this today. I got so happy at the first service today, I don't know how happy I might get in this service. I might walk the pew, just clear me a line out right there. I might walk it from the front to the back. Most of us will say, man, we could get, I know he's transitioning, but he's a famous lawyer. We could get Johnny Cochran to represent us. Man, if he could get OJ off. He can get us off, right? If it don't fit, we must be. Famous lines, right? Think about Jesus himself representing you to the Father. I pray that that sinks in, because the Father will not deny his Son. Trying to paint a picture of you, what's happening every time you go to the Father in his name. He takes the request and he presents it to the Father on your behalf. Let me go back again to go forward. However, when making atonement for Israel, the high priest must stand up to intercede in the Old Testament and perform the day of atonement ritual. So remember that. So the blood was on the mercy seat, right? And the blood on the mercy seat covered sins for the Old Testament believers for one calendar year, right? And then what the high priest would do would stand up and he would take the request of the people and he would present those requests and he would intercede on behalf of God or on behalf of the people to God for whatever prayer request needs that they had. And they are only able to do this once a year. Folks, think about this. We could come boldly to that throne of grace 25 times a day if we need to. And so really the picture is that we should be causing Jesus to sit down, stand up, sit down, stand up, sit down, stand up, sit down, stand up all day long. Right? Or on a consistent basis. So now, high priest would stand up to intercede and perform the Day of Atonement rituals. We won't go back and read this, but you remember in Acts chapter 7, when they were stoning Stephen, right? The scripture says that Stephen looked up into heaven. What did he see? He saw Jesus how? Yes. Standing at the right hand of God the Father. Well, why was he standing? Because to perform his high priestly duty, which is to intercede on behalf of the people to the Father, he stood up waiting on instructions from Stephen so that he could present those requests to the Father. And we won't go back and look at that today, right? And so Stephen's prayer request was simply this. This is how he shows you how full of Jesus you could be, that you could act just like him. Now the reality is, if you throw a rock at me, I'm probably getting ready to pick that same rock up and try to crack your head wide open. Okay, we just all be human beings in here for a minute. And if you run, I'm trying to catch you. I promise you. You know, right? You slap me. Most likely, I bet my initial response would be to slap you back. And I'm talking about, I wouldn't even think about it. Bam, bam! What? And it would be quick. Then I would realize, oh, my bad. You okay? Why are you flinching, man? Why are you jumping like that? You living okay? You living rough? I'm just jumping. He ready to jump at me. That's what he ready to do. But what's my point, though, here? Stephen got so full of God that his prayer request was simply this: Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. He was acting just like Jesus when Jesus was on the cross. So the Father took that request to the, or Jesus took that request to the Father. And at this time, you got to remember, he has already died. The blood has already been presented on the mercy seat. So he has to go to the Father and say, Father, we already paid for that sin. And even give the murderers a chance to get their lives together. How do we know that's true? Because they took the coats of the people that had stoned him and laid them at the feet of Paul. So Paul was the one that endorsed the killing. And he wasn't Paul at the time. He was Saul. And so clearly God had forgiven. forgiven everyone who took part in that, because Saul later on became Paul and wrote 3/4 of the New Testament. Come on, y'all don't want to go there. Come on, y'all don't want to go there. And you sitting up here stuck on custom. I'm just showing you. In God's eyes, it's all the same. If he'll forgive a murderer, you don't think he'll forgive somebody for custom? So I want you to see that God honored that request. You just let that sink in. God honored that request. Because Stephen said, forgive the people who murdered. I'm going somewhere with that today. Because you know, if somebody do something else, we'll stop speaking to them for the rest of our lives. Why is it so quiet in this Roman Catholic Church? You all just taking it in? Things that make you go. All right. So now let's just pick up all new information from here. And we said several things around that, right? You all remember as we ascend the ladder of prayer, a lot of things that happened in this heavenly throne, right? And one of the things that happened is that God, he's a righteous judge, right? And so what he's doing is he's getting those instructions and then he's releasing angels. He's speaking to men of God, women of God, who will listen to him in prayer, who will follow whatever instructions that he gives them, right? All kind of different things. People that are willing to be led where the gifts of the Spirit are concerned, word of wisdom, word of knowledge, gift of faith, miracle, all kind of different things. And he's releasing these things in the earth. And I'll give you an example of this. I went to the mailbox on yesterday, and you know, it wasn't anything we were believing for, but God spoke to someone in another state. I went out there, I opened it up. What anything we were believing for, it's just really the goodness of God. Open it up. I don't even know the name. I don't even recognize the name of the people, but it says, and Nova says, see, so, and that God basically had led them to sow into our marriage every single month until he tells them to stop. And so, praise God for that. I mean, that's a real blessing. You know? And so, I'm like, baby, you know who this is? When she finally came home, she said, oh yeah, I know exactly who that is. And she shared the story with me around it. And she was explaining to me how SoundCloud is a blessing for us. That's really all I can tell you. SoundCloud is a blessing to a lot of different people. We're pastoring more people that are sitting in this building. And I'm now starting to realize it may be time to start streaming these services live and pastor the world. We'll see where we go with that. But make a long story short, matter of fact, it's not even about that. But the point is, you all understand, God had to speak to someone else. They had to be in a position to listen in order to release to us. We weren't even believing for it. It's just really a blessing. All right? And so, like a good husband, what do? I figure out first what's the percentage, because I don't tithe anymore. I give above where you above that, right?
Yes, sir.
So I figure out what that percentage is, and I go beyond that, and I honor God. And then, obviously, I honor our household. So the next thing I'm going to do is figure out, babe, do you have any spending money? Make sure she has some spending money and give her some cash. I mean, a good husband makes sure his wife has cash. Oh, you all in the service now. Oh, church just started. Now, all the ladies are in the building now. Clapping, standing up, all kind of different things. Yeah, I took care of her, honored her. Obviously, I've already honored God in the service today, but this is how this works, folks. When we go up, then God immediately gives instructions and releases angels so that what it is that we present can come to pass in our lives.
Yeah.
All right? So now, let's talk about, and again, just give me about 20 minutes or so, 15, 20 minutes of your undivided attention. Let's talk about what this heavenly throne room looks like today, okay? Now, you must understand, we don't create, we discover. We don't invent, is a better way to say it. We discover what's already here. So a lot of what you see on the earth is just mimicking what's already in heaven. We think we just invented it, but really all we did was discover. All right, and so the heavenly throne room looks very similar to a earthly courtroom, okay? Let me show you. Go with me to Psalms number 50. God is the judge. Folks, I'm telling you, I'm so glad he's the judge, I don't know what to do. Does that mean the case is already fixed? Why? Because the Lord is on my side. What can man do unto me? Okay? And God is the righteous judge. Psalms 56 says, let the heavens declare his righteousness. For God himself is what? judge. Now, I've always said to myself, if I would judge myself, then God wouldn't have to judge me. Or if I would convict myself, God wouldn't have to convict me. So when I realize I've been judged about something, it's because I didn't judge myself on it. I believe God always gives us the opportunity first to make it right. When he has to get involved, it's because we didn't listen to the preacher, we didn't listen to the word of wisdom, word of knowledge, we didn't read, study the Bible for ourselves. Hello, somebody. Yeah. Right? When he has to get involved, and really his judgment is still going to be to lead you back towards him. Whatever it is, it's still going to be good, all right? And so God is a righteous judge. So I want to say certain things about this. We all live life. Life happens to all of us. There may be times throughout the course of your life where you get mistreated, where maybe you're removed or fired unjustly, where someone does something to you that you didn't deserve. I want you to be clear. You can appeal to a higher court. Yeah. Right? So don't fight people. Just take your request before a higher courtroom and let God fight your battle for you. How many know at the end of the day, God is even going to make whatever went wrong right if you have enough faith to believe him in spite of what just happened to you. Because he's a righteous judge. So stop fighting people and start trusting God. And remember, there's nothing anyone can do to you if God is on your side. Even if it looks like temporarily they got away with something, it's only temporary before God not only makes it better, but he's going to make sure that what he gives you is far better than what they took away from you. Right? Because he's a good judge. And so you should get to a place where you can't wait to present your case to God. Right? And so he is the judge. Jesus is the advocate or the lawyer. Go with me to 1 John chapter 2. Now, justice ministers on the front row, anyone in this building. First time I've ever seen this in my life. Been reading this verse all my life. So, just thought it was about something else. Let me great show you what it's about. Let me show you really what our lawyer is always advocating on our behalf. 1 John chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. Now, this will need to be judged, okay? So follow along. Make sure you look at your Bible, follow along with me, okay? So we've got God as the judge, Jesus as the advocate or the lawyer. And again, if I know he's representing me, man, I am good to go. It's just a formality now. I mean, we just got to go through the process because I already know the result of this particular judgment right here. Now watch this. My little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. Stay with me very slowly. And if anyone sins, notice it's not expected that you do. Hello? Sin has no power over a true born again believer. Stay with me now. And if anyone sins, so the subject of this verse is what? Sin. Watch this. If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father. What is an advocate with the Father? A lawyer. If we sin, we have an advocate with the Father. What is the purpose of that? Jesus then goes to the Father and tells the Father, I already took care of it. I'm getting ready to go real slow. Jesus then goes to the Father and said, my blood already paid the price for you. So the revelation is, folks, I'm not trying to be forgiven. I've already been forgiven. So even when I go to the Father, I'm not asking him to do something he's already done for me. I'm saying, Father, for what I just did, I thank you that that's already forgiven. And Father, I know that your grace doesn't teach. And so, Father, I believe by faith and confess that I've already overcome in Jesus' name. Amen. See the difference? Yeah. Stay with me now. Let's go real slow. We have an advocate with the Father. Notice the emphasis here. Jesus Christ, the righteous. Why does it say Jesus Christ, the righteous? Because it's his righteousness, not ours. Isaiah chapter 64 says that our righteousness is as what? Filthy rags. So you don't ever want to come into the presence of the Father talking about how great you are. Because the reality is if we come home with you and live with you for a week, Some of y'all, we don't even have to go that far. We just go right out to the car. How many of y'all would say, Pastor, stay right here for a minute while I change this channel? While I change the station. Let me get this news. Oh, hold on, Pastor. Let me see if I can get somebody else to take you home. I want to go somewhere with this. Isn't it interesting here how the emphasis is on Jesus Christ, the righteous? All right, I'm going to take you on a journey here real quick. I don't have time to take you as far as I want to take you. Folks, this is never about us. The sin issue has already been dealt with. You know what hinders us in prayer? It's a sin consciousness. And we begin to determine for ourselves whether or not we're worthy or not based off of how we see ourselves, instead of seeing ourselves the way he sees us. Right? And if you don't understand he made you a certain way, then you can never walk in the fullness of a relationship with God the way he designed for you to be. The only thing you will focus on is what you did wrong. And the only thing he's focusing on is how he forgave you. Right, let me give you an example. It's Matthew chapter 6. Interesting revelation. You don't have to turn here. Interesting revelation that God gave you. You know, the earlier part of Matthew chapter 6, he's talking about don't seek things to wear, put on, right? What you're going to eat, what you're going to drink. It's interesting that he said, because your father already knows that you have need. Okay, so where I come from, if I don't have them and you know I need them, that's a deadbeat day. Right or wrong? If I don't have them, but look at the lesson that he's teaching. Then he said, but, which cancels out everything else up to that point. Seek ye first the kingdom of God, verse 33. So what's the kingdom of God? Folks, it's already built in. When you do things this way, it releases everything in the kingdom that already belongs to you. Right? But notice, he never saw this before. He said, but seek ye first the kingdom of God, and this is very careful, and his righteousness, not yours. We've always thought, I've got to do something. But he already did it. My job is to receive it. Let me go real slow. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 says, he who knew no sin became sin for us so that we could be the righteousness of God. That's positionally, folks. There's nothing we did to earn that. So there's nothing we can do to improve upon that. So if you understand what he's saying there, stay in the kingdom and know that I've made you right. And everything else that you need is already in the kingdom. Right? So, I use this one example. I mean, tithing is a kingdom principle. You can believe whatever you want to believe about it. I'm getting ready to come and teach you along these lines. People say in the New Testament, we don't have to do that. In the New Testament, it all belongs to us. And the worst you can do, the minimum you can do is 10%. So once I got the revelation 3 years ago, now I've gone way beyond it. And every year I go up a percentage in my giving. And I've noticed that every time I brought him up, guess what he's done? Brought me up. And it comes from everywhere. I'm talking about it comes from all, everywhere. Right? I'm going somewhere with this now. I've been saved since I was 22 years old. My credit score has been over 800 since I was 22 years old. I've never had a bill not get paid. Amen. Hello, somebody. Amen. Let me tell you why. Because I live in the kingdom. And every time I tithe, folks, I'm going to release the benefits of the kingdom that I live in. And now that I'm getting a greater revelation of who I am in him, it's not based off of my merit. It changes my whole disposition. So now I'm not trying to get much of anything. What I'm doing is receiving what I already have. That just belongs to me as kingdom children. My children are not waking up, Dad, can I have some cereal? No, they go and get the cereal and eat it. Because they're Gregory kids. It belongs to
them. Come on, Pastor.
Once you know who you are, the game changes. Pray that you're listening to that. Isn't that interesting? That his primary responsibility for us as an advocate or lawyer is to address the sin issue that we struggle with. knows he doesn't struggle with it. We do. If I'm always thinking about it, how many of you know I'm always struggling? If I'm always thinking about who I am in here, I don't have time to think about sin.
Amen.
I'm just trying to work this principle. Let me take it a step further. Okay? I shared with you Thursday night. I don't play with my marriage. You know, they won't listen to me. You won't find a female anywhere. Look me straight in my eye. You won't find a female anywhere that will tell you I did anything inappropriate where she's concerned. You won't find her anywhere. You put this on SoundCloud. You can post this on my Facebook page. You can follow me around. You can do whatever you want to do. You won't find a female anywhere that will even say I said something wrong to her. And I don't play with this. And I'm going to tell you why. I'm at the gym, let's say a week and a half, 2 weeks ago. New female trainer in there. She sees me working out on my core. She said, why are you on a machine? Let me show you how to really use your body weight to work your core a lot better. And let me train, let me show you a few exercises, and then I'll give you a few free lessons. And my wife happened to be in the gym on this day. I'll give you a few free lessons, and then you can kind of get yourself going on your own. So I said to her, well, I really don't train with female trainers without my wife. So my wife is right up there on that treadmill right there. Why don't you go ask her? And if she agrees, then the two of us will do those free sessions with you. True story. God is my witness. True story. But you know how relentless people can be. So I'm in the gym on yesterday. She walks right back up to me again. I'm on a different machine doing core work. And she says, you still on these machines? I stopped at me. I said, you're still talking. I told you, I'm willing to work out with you. Did you clear it through my wife first? Because I'm not working out with you by myself. I'm only working out with you for free if this includes my wife. True story, God's my witness. Where is that coming from, folks? That's coming from not I'm afraid to sin. That's coming from who I am in Him. And I'm unwilling to let somebody mess that up. Watch this. Get ready to go real slow. And He Himself, Jesus, not us, is the propitiation for our sins. What does the word propitiation mean? Greek word here, hilesmos. H-I-L-A-S-M-O-S. Guess what it means, folks? Means atonement. But this time, it's not just for 1 year to cover. This time, it's forever removed.
Amen.
And I don't know about you, if you didn't get nothing else today, you ought to lift your hands to the Father and thank Him that your sin has been forever removed. I pray that you're getting this. It's going to change your prayer life. So now it's just, which one do you think about all the time? All I think about is sin, and what I do is sin. That's called being carnally minded. And it produces death. So notice, God didn't do anything to it. I wanted just my thinking. But when I think righteousness and right standing, it produces kingdom results. Sin is not the issue because I'm not thinking about it. I can't struggle with what I'm not thinking about. Still with me out here? Okay. Not for ours only, but also for the what? The whole world. So now let's go back to Stephen. They just killed him. So God just didn't die for Stephen. Oh, Jesus didn't die for Stephen. He died for everyone. Stephen understood. And he said, Father, forgive them. They don't understand what they're doing. We don't have a record of how many of them may have had their lives changed. Maybe even through the ministry of Saul, who later became Paul. Right? But if they couldn't think about it, they only saw themselves as a murderer, how could they walk away from it? So I'm going somewhere with this today. How could Paul, listen to what Paul said in his book of Acts. He said, I've wronged no man. No, that's not true, Paul. You killed. You were putting Christians in jail. You murdered Christians. But somehow, Paul got a revelation of what Christ made him. And he said, I wronged no man. The woman was caught in adultery, wasn't she? had to have her say, you know what, keep this. So then he can say, I will keep it. You don't understand this, folks. You cannot have a proper prayer life, relationship with God. You don't see him or see yourself the way he sees you. You all still with me in this building? I had sex prior to marriage. I asked God, 22 years of age, to make me a spiritual virgin all the time. So I no longer saw myself as a womanizer. I saw myself as a man of God. Who deserved a woman of God. And I said, God, send me the best one you have in your garden. And I'll take care of it for the rest of my life. 8 years later, folks, I married her. The next time I slept with someone was my wife on our wedding night. And guess what, folks? I was like a virgin all over. You all already know the story. It was over before it started. That's all I'll say about that life. I saw her. And it was over before the party even started. All I can say is just hold me. I'll be back. Just let me take a nap. Just let me take a nap. I'll be back. Woke up from that nap. It was over again. Thank God I'm not the man I used to be. I've had 18 years of practice now. And I've developed a little over these 18 years. To God be the glory. All right. Go to Revelation chapter 4. Let's look at verse 4. So we've got God the judge, right? We've got Jesus the advocate. What is the primary issue that the lawyer is dealing with? Sin. Every time we come to the Father, Jesus is reminding the Father, I'm getting ready to get ahead of myself. Because you have an accuser that's going to come right in there also and try to say, you can't do that for them because they did this. Right? Just like he comes to you and says, you can't go to the Father because you did that. Right? Watch this. Revelation chapter 4. There are 24 elders who serve as the jury. Revelation chapter 4 verse 4 says, around the throne there were 24 thrones, and on the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white robes, and they had crowns of gold on their heads. So how many know what a jury like that, when they go back to deliberate, you know, it's coming back not guilty every single time. Then go with me to Revelation chapter 12. Then Satan appears in the heavenly court as the prosecutor. Try to stack a case against you. Back in 1998. They used to smoke weed. Hang out in the club. Hello, somebody. Stretch your hand. We all come from somewhere. Prosecutor comes in. Back in 2002, they cheated on their taxes. Don't put your head down now. If you do that, keep your head up. Keep looking at it. But that's what the prosecutor does. Then in 2008, they drove around with no insurance. Broke the law. And we can go on and on and on and on. Right? And that's all the prosecutor's job is to remind God of what you've done wrong and to remind you of what you've done. The lawyer is there to remind God of what he did right and how what he did right covered what you did wrong. Come on. And this is happening on a daily basis. Prosecutor comes in and tries to present a case as to why you don't deserve it. The lawyer comes in and says it's not based off of Father anything that they've done. It's only based, their request is based off of what I've done. And Father, the blood points to the mercy seat has already forgiven them. And not only did it forgive them, it removed it from them. And Father, I just want to remind you, you said that as far as the east is from the west, so far as you remove their transgressions from them. You said their sins you blot out and remember them no more. And so, Father, I'm interceding on their behalf. Do this for them. Now the Father doesn't see us. He only sees his son. And he sees the price that his son paid. And how many of y'all know he's got to kick the prosecutor out of there because he's already been defeated? Right? But just like any fool, how many of you know they always think they can come back and win one, right? So watch this now, Revelation chapter 12. So then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ has come. For the accuser of the brethren, who is that? All right, watch this. Who accused them before God, how often? He doesn't stop. Don't you ever notice that anytime you make the effort to go to God, some thoughts come in your head? Anyone in here willing to be honest? You ever notice that if something doesn't go right, some kind of thought comes into your head, it's because of something you did wrong? Right? And if you just do this, then that wouldn't have happened. You got to recognize who that is. That's the accuser of the brethren. That's why 2 Corinthians chapter 10 says, casting down every thought and imagination that would try to exalt itself against the knowledge of God. Bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. You got to turn that right back around and say, no, I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And I have a right to present this request, not based off of anything that I've done, but based off of everything that Jesus has done. And his blood has cleansed me from all sin and unrighteousness. Not only has it cleansed me from it, but it's completely removed it out of my life. And you can stand before the Father just like Paul when he said, I wrong no man. You can stand before the Father and know that you literally have wronged no man. So many people are keeping themselves in prison over a divorce, over a mistake that they made in their marriage. Let it go, because God is letting it go. There's life after that, and there's a good life after that. Just make sure that you learn from it and you get better. See what Jesus said to her, right? I won't condemn you, now go and sin no more. The only thing he wants is that you get better, not bitter. All right, watch this. So he goes before the throne day and night, has been cast down. And they overcame him, watch this again, by the what? Blood. How do we overcome him? Blood. Once again, folks, what does the blood deal with? The sin issue. Isn't that interesting that his primary role in the throne is to remind the Father that our sin has already been removed? Right? And to remind us that we are right with him. Those two truths you have to live in order to walk in the fullness of everything that God has. What's the first truth? I'm not a sinner. Sinner has no power over me. Anything that I've ever done, doing, and will do has already been forgiven. And he has made me right now. You know, if you're single in here, you start thinking you don't deserve a queen. Men start thinking they don't deserve God's best. So they'll go out and deal with it other kind of women. And that's not because of how he sees you. That's because of how you see yourself. Then the other side of that, females will start seeing themselves because they made mistakes. And they're like, I don't deserve a good guy. So they go deal with different kind of guys. And that's not the way he sees you. That's the way you see yourself. And I'm telling you, when you see yourself this way, you deserve the best that God has out there. Yeah. I'm talking about a guy with a job. Yeah. A good job, too. That can give you the option to work or not to work. Yes, sir. I bet Faith getting ready to rise in here now. I'm talking about his job can pay for two cars. His job can pay for where you live. I'm talking about that's the kind of guy that you deserve. That'll honor your body prior to marriage. I didn't like that response right there. But that's the kind of guy that you deserve. That'll lead that effort and respect and honor your body prior to marriage. Not only will he honor it prior to marriage, he'll honor it after marriage. It's a blessing to be able to go to sleep knowing your man is not cheating on you. Sleep good at night when you know your man that's good to you. You deserve that. But if you don't see yourself that way, then you try to, in your own marriage, make it happen and play house. Y'all glad you came to church. And y'all can say there are a few situations out there I can look at and say that was all me. Raise your hand. Let's just put that in neutral. Let's let God do it the next time. Can everybody agree on that in here? Let him do it for you. Alright? I'm going to close right here. I think you all get the point today. Alright? So now, says, they overcame the enemy by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. You know what the greatest testimony you can ever have is? I'm forgiven of all sin and unrighteousness, and I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. There's no greater testimony you can have than to say you've been forgiven for every sin that you've ever done, doing, and will do, and you are the righteousness of God in Christ. Every other testimony is the byproduct of that one testimony. I'm forgiven. I'm not trying to be forgiven. I'm forgiven. I'm not trying to be right with God. I am right with God right now. Everything in the kingdom, I have a right to enjoy. Why? Because I'm a son and a child of the King. I'm an heir of God and a joint heir with Jesus Christ. Everything that belongs to Jesus belongs to me, and it belongs to me right now. See the difference? And if I can walk in that every day, that I'm forgiven and I'm right with God. Now, how many of you, we're human beings. We're going to make mistakes. Right? Just when you make them, know that you're already forgiven. And spend more time focusing on you being right with God than what you did wrong. And focusing more on being right with God will keep you free from what you did. Did you all catch that? Let's close this. Love not our lives to the depths. So the primary purpose of the heavenly temple is to deal with the issue twofold. We've been forgiven of sin, and we are right with God. All right? Can you see yourself that way? I'm talking about right now. So let me tell you, if I was living with someone that I wasn't married to, this is how I would see that. Right now, God forgave me of that. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And then watch what that's going to do. My actions are going to begin to follow. Yeah. I start seeing myself, God forgave me of this, and I'm right with God. I'm going to eventually go to her and say, you know what? We can't keep living.
Amen.
Right? If I see it the other way, man, I can't believe I keep doing this. I'm living in this situation. I know I'm disappointing God. But I'm in it. I know you'd never come out. If I was struggling with alcohol, you know what I would say? While pouring a drink, Christ already forgave me. And I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And I have overcome alcohol in Jesus' name. I might take a sip of it, but I guarantee you it's getting ready to be less and less and less because I'm not focusing on I'm an alcoholic. I'm focusing on if it were me and I was single and I was out here fornicating, I wouldn't see myself as a fornicator. Even if it just happened yesterday, I would see myself as forgiven. Say, God, I know I'm forgiven of this, and you made me the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Father, I receive your forgiveness, and I stand in your righteousness. And if the more I focus on that, the less attractive fornication is going to be. I hope you catch it. I'm not cheating on my wife because she's so great. I'm not cheating on my wife because he's so great. So I focus more on how much he loves me. I focus more on that than how much my wife loves me. And every time I remind myself of what he's done for me, I don't want to do anything to hurt her. I don't want to do anything to go against that. And then she sits in a position where she benefits. The moment I shift that, and now it's about how you need to look to keep me, she can never look at me. I hope you all catching this. If I base this off of her performance, she can't perform well, just like I can. Which means we can't stay together. But when you get two people focusing on what he did and what he made us, it takes the pressure off each other. And now we can just enjoy each other, good, bad, and indifferent. So now I'm ready to put pressure on her. She didn't come up in that area. I don't do a whole lot of stuff. I don't come up in either. It's all right. We just work on this stuff together. We come up together. Let's not sweat over this little stuff. I love you. You love me. Let's go get some ice cream. And enjoy. You know what I'm saying? And this revelation, folks, I'm just walking in. I've been saying 28 years, and I'm just starting to walk into 40 and get fully delivered from legalism. Right, where I think I've got to do something to get God to do something. So primary purpose of the heavenly temple is to deal with the issue of forgiveness of sins. For those who believe upon the Lord. Same temple, however, I want to be clear on this, is a throne of judgment, where decisions are made about life and death. I want to be clear, folks. There's a heaven to gain and a hell to shun. Is everybody clear? You just focus on the law of life. You don't have to worry about the results of sin and death. That's why I didn't spend a whole lot of time. See, a lot of messages are, you're going to go to hell if you keep, and folks, nobody ever changes. They're scared as I don't know what, and they, you know, all kind of different things. They mostly respond to that altar call, but no one ever changes. Until you start focusing on what he made you, you can't change until you receive what he made you. Everybody clear on that? You don't have to turn there. I'm done. In John chapter 16, verse 24, we're talking about the blessing of answered prayer. And I think he laid it out for us perfectly there in John chapter 16. He said, ask the Father, anything that you ask the Father in my name, he's going to do it for you. And then he describes why. So that your joy can be full. You can see that's the heart and the desire of the Father, that you come to him through Jesus so that he can give you and you can receive, so that the joy that you already have can become full. So notice, he expects that you already have joy whether you've received anything from him or not. It's just the receiving of it causes the joy that you already have to now boil over out to other people. Now, I don't know about you. I don't think no true born-again believer should ever have a bad attitude. I don't believe that. I believe every born-again believer should be full of joy. Whether their circumstances are favorable or unfavorable, they should have some joy in their life. They should wake up every day. This is the day that the Lord, just the fact that you woke up and you have another day, should produce some kind of joy in your life, that you can walk out of that house and express that joy to other people. People ask you how you're doing. Stop all of that bad attitude. It's Monday, all that stuff. No, I'm doing great. Man, this is a great day, and I'm expecting great things to happen. I don't care if nothing's going great. If you'll confess that it's great, how many know great things are getting ready to start happening in your life? And this should be a trademark for us as believers, that we have joy 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year, 52 weeks out of the year. We are full and we have joy because God has been good. You are not in a hospital today. You don't have tubes coming out of your nose. You're not being fed with some kind of feeder going through your side. Folks, there's not a machine breathing for you. You are breathing on your own. And the scripture says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Glory to God. Folks, we should be different than the world, not act just like the world. So many bad attitudes in church. Come on, nobody wants to be around somebody with a bad attitude. Nobody wants to live with that. No one wants to be around that. A poor, negative disposition only brings negative things into your life. But a positive disposition brings positive things in your life. This is an opportunity. I woke up today. God can do something great in my life today. Let me attack this day with everything that God has put on the inside of me. Let me believe. Let me dream. Come on, somebody. God didn't bring us to the West End. He didn't bring us to Marietta. We're not trying to get a building, folks. We already have a building that has been paid for, cash, debt-free. We're just simply waiting to walk in it. But it's already been set up. It's already sitting out there for us. The money is coming even as I speak right now. God is speaking to men, women, boys, girls, all around the world to send resources to this location so that we can walk in the fullness of what he already provided. Hallelujah. 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 You'll just have more joy in your life. You'll see more positive things happen in your life on a more consistent basis. Stop looking like you've been sucking a sour lemon all day long. We should see your teeth. We should sense your joy. We should see the smile on your face. You learn how to compliment people. Tell people you look good today. God is good today. I like your shoes. I like that outfit. I love where God is taking you. You're a good person, and good things are getting ready to happen for you. Stay on God's side, because God is for you. Nobody can be against you. There should be so much life in this building with just us complimenting each other, speaking life into each other, looking out for each other, enjoying each other. I'm tired of this old sad, beat up, beat down. I wouldn't want to go to church if I looked at everybody that I have to look at all the time. We ought to be, if we have the good stuff, then why don't we act like we have the good stuff? Hallelujah. Before you even get out of your car, say attitude, stay your funky self in this car. I'm getting ready to go into the house of God, and I'm getting ready to give God glory because God has been good to me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He said, ask that you may receive so that your joy, then if you don't have any joy, it's because you're not asking. And you know why you're not asking? Because you don't believe you've been forgiven. Not only do you not believe you've been forgiven, you don't see yourself the way he sees you. That revelation right there alone will keep you full of joy. Hallelujah. 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 If I was single, I'd be walking around here like, man, I'm the best thing that ever happened to somebody. Boy, when they walk into this, they're getting ready to walk into a life-changing miracle in their life. I wouldn't see myself no other way than the best thing that could ever happen to somebody on planet Earth is when they met me and we got together and we did it the right way and we came together. There's no other way I'd allow myself to see myself. I wouldn't care how many times I was rejected. I would only see that if that's their way, not mine. And God has something better for me. Come on home, baby. Come on home. Come on home, next location. Come into our possession. It's time. Come on in. Hallelujah. 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 say I am forgiven.
I am forgiven.
Right now.
Right now.
Every sin.
Every sin.
That I've ever done.
That I've
ever done. That I'm
doing.
That I'm doing.
That I will do.
Has already been. Forgiven.
I am.
Right
now. Right now.
The righteousness of God.
In Christ Jesus.
Everything that he made me.
I'm blessed.
I'm healed.
I'm forgiven.
I'm prosperous.
I'm saved.
I'm set apart.
I'm holy.
God is good.
And he is good
all the time
to me.
Now lift your voice and give God.
Says in the presence of the Lord, there's fullness of joy. And at his right hand, if you understand his right hand, that's what he uses to bless you. Our pleasures forevermore. What keeps me out of his presence is out of sin. And I don't believe I'm supposed to be there. So if I'm not in his presence, how many know I can't have no joy? Then the scripture says, the joy of the Lord is in your strength. So if I don't have no joy, then I'm not strong. I'm not strong to deal with everything that the enemy is getting ready to accuse me of. This is entire day. I'm out of time. Let's all stand to us. Hallelujah. Lift your hands to the Father.